تبسم 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 تبسم
تبسم تبسم وخل الهموم وخل الغموم وخل الضجر ولا تبتئس من صروف الزمان.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Respected viewers, continuing on our program, outlining and explaining some of the verses that are recited in Taraweeh. Tonight we are doing the 12 juz of the Holy Quran, which is the 11th night of the Taraweeh, based on the Taraweeh being completed on the 29th night of Ramadan. The 12 juz of the Holy Quran coincides with the first verse of Surah Hud. Surah Hud starts off from the last ruku of the 11 juz of the Holy Quran. Surah Hud is a very significant surah of the Holy Quran. One day some of the companions came to our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Prophet of Almighty Allah, we see that there are signs of age appearing on you. Your beard is becoming white and there are white strands of hair. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, certain surahs, certain chapters have made me old. And he even made mention of Surah Hud, saying, Shayyibani Hud. Surah Hud has made me old. Our ulama and our learned scholars left nothing to chance. And they looked through Surah Hud and they said, what is the ayat and what is the verse that perhaps Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to when he said that Surah Hud has made me old? And one of the verses which many of the ulama feel is the verse that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to appears right in the last ruku and part of the surah, where Allah Ta'ala says, وَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتْ, be steadfast upon what Allah has commanded you to do. And this might seem a very short command, but it is very broad in its implication. Because Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, irrespective of the situation that you find yourself in, always adhere and remain steadfast upon the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nevertheless, it is a very significant surah. And the chapter and the juz itself starts off with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making mention of one of his great responsibilities. And Allah ta'ala says, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا. There is not a living creature on this earth the sustenance of which is not upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has taken the responsibility of sustaining each and every living creature in this universe. And it is amazing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has manifest this great responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says risk and sustenance is upon Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Continuing on this, in the second ruku, Allah Ta'ala gives a beautiful explanation of human beings being prone to haste and impulsiveness. And look at how beautifully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts it. And this is the ninth verse of the surah. وَلَيْنَ ذَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنَّا رَحْمَةً ثُمَّ نَزَعْنَاهَا مِنْ إِنَّهُ لَيَهُوسٌ كَفُورٌ. If Allah Ta'ala gives easy condition and rahmat and mercy to human beings, and then Allah Ta'ala snatches it away, إِنَّهُ لَيَعُوسٌ كَفُورٌ, he becomes despondent. He becomes despondent of Allah. And he starts complaining about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَيْنْ عَذَقْنَاهُ نَعْمَاءَ بَعْدَ دَرَّهُ. And if Allah Ta'ala brings easy conditions, Allah gives him ni'mat, Allah gives him favors after the difficulty, then لَيَقُولَنَّ ذَهَبَ السَّيِّئَةُ عَنِّي. Then human being says, difficulty has fled far away from me, it has left me. إِنَّهُ لَفَرِحٌ فَخُورٌ, he becomes happy, he becomes proud, he becomes arrogant. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, except the one who perseveres, who has sabr, and who does righteous deeds. These two types of situations would not overtake a person who perseveres upon the commands of Almighty Allah. Which Allah Ta'ala tells us that these two conditions are not like by Allah. To be despondent when difficult conditions come, and to be proud and arrogant when easy conditions come and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about ease and favors upon you, because both are a test from the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Continuing on this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a most beautiful example with regard to the end of the second ruku of the supara. Allah Ta'ala says, مَثَلُ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ كَالْعَمَى وَالْعَصَمِّ وَالْبَصِيرِ وَالسَّمِيعِ. Allah gives you the example of two groups of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given these two groups of people in terms of the physical manifestation. One is asam wal basir, kal a'ma wal asami wal basiri wal sami, the one who can see and the one who can hear, and the one who is blind and the one who is deaf. Allah ta'ala gives the example of one who does righteous deeds to the one who can see and the one who can hear. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the one who does evil deeds, he resembles the one who is blind and who is deaf. Then to illustrate this point, the next few rukus, Allah Ta'ala gives examples of various Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, how they came into contact with the people confronted them, turned away from the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, from the messengers of the Almighty, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with them. And the first of those incidents is a remarkable incident. It is so full of lessons. Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to his people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he told unto his people that Allah ta'budu illallah, do not worship anyone besides Allah. I fear a severe chastisement that will come upon you if you do not worship and serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah in the 27th verse of the surah says, قال الملأ الذين كفروا من قومه ما نراك إلا بشرا مثلنا وما نراك اتبعك إلا الذين هم أراذلنا بعدي الرعي وما نرى لكم علينا من فضل بل نظنكم كاذبين. The leaders of the nation told unto Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, we see you like an ordinary human being like us, and we do not see the people who are following you as people of influence, people of wealth, people who have great opinion. They are of shallow opinion. In fact, we do not see you people as dignified, but we see you as a liar. And what was his reply? Something worthy of capturing into our hearts. Ya Qawm, O my tribe, I don't ask you any material benefit for you to follow the message which I have brought from the Almighty. La asalukum alayhi ajra, I don't ask of you any financial remuneration. In ajriya illa ala Allah, my reward is with Allah. وَنَمَا أَنَا بِطَارِدِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, and I would not dissociate myself from those people who have brought iman upon me, even if you feel them that they are poor and they lack influence. إِنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ, they would lead and they would meet the Allah, and Allah will deal with them according to their intention. وَيَا قَوْمِ مَنْ يَنْصُرُنِي مِنَ اللَّهِ إِنْ تَرَدْتُمْ, O my tribe, who will help me if I have to dissociate myself from those people whom you say they are poor? And then this conversation continues until they told, Ya Nuh, قَدْ جَادَلْتَنَا فَأَكْثَرْتَ جِدَالَنَا, O Nuh, you have argued with us tremendously. Now bring your punishment that you are promising us about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then told unto Musa, Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam, وَأُوحِيَ إِلَىٰ نُوحٍ أَنَّهُ لَيْ يُؤْمِنَ مِنْ قَوْمِكِ إِلَّا مَنْ قَدْ آمَنَ, O Nuh, we reveal unto Nuh that no one will bring iman now except those who have already brought iman. Historians narrate at that time, after some over 900 years of effort, only 80 people brought iman upon Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Truth cannot be contained and cannot be determined by the amount of people who are following you. So Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was told this and told to make an ark. And when he was told to make an ark and a ship in the middle of the desert in a place where there was not much rain, obviously, the people mocked at Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, and they made mention with regard to it. Qala kullama marra alayhi mala'u min qawmi sakhiru min. Allah says in the 38th verse of the surah, every time they came past Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam building the ship in the ark, they mocked at him. And he said, in taskharu minna, if you mock at me, one day I will laugh at you for repelling and going against the commands of Allah. And the way it is said, the one who laughs last loves the best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then goes on to say, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam embarked upon the ship with these beautiful words, Bismillahi majreha wa mursaha inna rabbi laghafuru rahim. Verse 41 of this surah, O Allah, in your name do I embark, and on your name will I disembark. Only everything belongs to you, and you are most forgiving and most merciful. Then a most poignant moment in this incident has been made mention in the 42nd verse of the surah. وهي تجري بهم في موج كالجبال. ونادى نوح ابنه وكان في معزله: يا بني اركب معنا ولا تكن مع الكافرين. As Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam came onto the ship with a pair of all the different animals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he saw his son who was with the disbelievers, and he told unto his son, "O my son, come with us and do not be with the disbelievers." And they said, "Sahawi ila jabal." The son replied, "I will go to the mountain tops. I will save myself from the flood waters. Surely the flood waters will not be able to reach the top of the mountains." And Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam replied, "La asim al yawma min amri Allahi illa man rahim." Oh my son, none will be able to be saved from Allah's punishment. Even if you go to any part of the world, even if you go to the top of the mountain, only the one whom Allah has mercy upon would be saved from this flood that has come as a punishment from Almighty Allah. And Allah, in the 43rd verse of the surah, so beautifully makes mention of it. وَحَالَ بَيْنَهُمَ الْمَوْجِ. While the father and son were conversing, a wave came in between the two. The father is a great prophet of the Almighty, a great messenger of the Almighty. And the son dies as a disbeliever. Hidayat is in the hands of Almighty Allah. Therefore, seek and pursue Hidayat with great enthusiasm, listeners and viewers. Then Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam made dua to Almighty Allah after the receding of the flood water. And he said, "Oh Allah, you have promised that you would save my family members." فَقَالَ رَبِّ إِنَّ بْنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي. My son was also from amongst my family members. وَإِنَّ وَعْدَكَ الْحَقِّ. And your promise is the truth, and you are most fair in your judgments and in your determinations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied, "Ya Nuh, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِي." Oh Nuh, he is not worthy of being from amongst your family. He might be your biological son, but he is not worthy in terms of his morals, in terms of being your son, because you are such a great messenger and you proclaim the message of the Almighty. And he went against the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ. His amal and his deeds were not righteous. Then the Almighty continues by giving many other examples. One example which is in the seventh part of the whole of this surah, the seventh ruku of this surah, Allah Ta'ala speaks about the incident of Lut alayhi salatu wasalam. We know that the tribe of Lut alayhi salatu wasalam were involved in homosexuality, which in the Quran is regarded to be a sexual perversion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention that how they turned against not only Lut alayhi salatu wasalam, even wanted to fulfill their desires with the angels who came in the form of handsome young men. And how Hazrat Lut alayhi salatu wasalam was so, you know, anxious. And after that anxiety, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, told him not to be anxious. And eventually, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed that nation in a very severe way because of the sexual perversion. And that is made mention in the seventh ruku of the surah. Then just before the last quarter, just towards the end of the surah, we start off a surah known as Surah Yusuf. Now, Surah Yusuf is a very amazing surah of the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to it as, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَكَدْ نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. We give you the best of stories. Why is it the best of stories? Various reasons. One is the great lessons. Secondly, it also speaks about Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the way Yusuf alayhi salatu wa sallam was taken out of his homeland by his brothers, forced out of his homeland by his brothers, and then returned triumphantly. In the same way, the people of Makkah, they forced Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam out of Makkah. And one day Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would triumphantly come back. That is why he's known as Ahsan al-Qasas, the best of surahs, the best of incidents. Then also another aspect with regard to it being the best of incidents is, nowhere in the Holy Quran does Allah Ta'ala describes an incident from the beginning to the end, but in this incident. And the reason is that to tell a story, to narrate a narrative, is also part of human experience. And how do you narrate it? In this incident, Allah has given us the way how to narrate a narrative. Don't go into so much details that people lose a lesson. And don't be so short that you lose the essence of the lesson. Therefore, this is known as Ahsan al-Qasas. We do not have much time, but I would just like to give one incident, which is a poignant moment, which tells about that when Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was put into the well by his brothers, he was sold into slavery. he came towards Misr and he came into the house of the governor of Egypt. And the wife of the governor tried to seduce Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam because of his attractiveness, because of his piety, because of his beauty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the 23rd verse of Surah Yusuf says, وَرَاوَدَتْهُ الَّتِي هُوَ فِي بَيْتِهَا عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. The woman in whose house he was tried to seduce him. وَغَلَّقَتِ الْأَبْوَابِ. And she locked up the doors and she said, come towards me. And Allah ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ هَمَّدْ بِهِ. She desired him with passion. He would have also have desired her had it not been for Allah protecting him and him seeing and realizing the greatness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pronounces innocence. The incident is a long one. We don't have the time to go into it. Just one or two moments and one or two incidents we highlight with the intention of taking lessons. And in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrates these incidents with the intention of us taking lessons from there. May we be guided by these lessons and may we be granted inspiration. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
لنحس في أعماقنا الإيمان.